Richard Etienne, my guest today, has over 15 years of experience working with the public, private, and third sectors as a communications consultant, specializing in personal and corporate brand development, internal and external focus campaigns, and promotional film production. Richard's expertise shone brightly during his time at 10 Downing Street, where, as Theresa May's personal videographer, he used the connection of social media to transform Mrs. May's persona into one that showed a softer, more emotive side right up until her very last public speech. Now, as a leadership consultant to politicians, artists, and retired sports stars, Richard takes pride in helping his clients and stakeholders to communicate effectively and from a place of trust and authenticity. With a strong love for filmmaking, Richard's work has been featured on countless national and international broadcasters, including the BBC, Channel 4, and ITV. Richard's debut documentary, The ID Project, won Best Documentary at the 2019 British Urban Film Festival and won the Film Reel Award at the 2019 Carib Film Festival in Miami, Florida. He was recently appointed to the Board of Trustees at Hackney Empire in a year the historic landmark will celebrate 120 years since it first welcomed theatergoers through its doors. He currently teaches Guardian Masterclass series classes called Self-Promotion for Introverts and How to Succeed as an Introverted Professional. And he's also the founder of the Introvert Space and Black Introvert Week in the UK. Welcome, Richard. I'm so thrilled to have you on the Introvert Ally podcast.
Hi, Jennifer. Yeah, thank you for having me. I really appreciate being here right now.
Well, how are you? You're calling in from England, so you're kind of winding down your day.
Yeah, it's still summer months here, so the sun is up. This is wonderful, and it's been a lovely day. It's been a great week, you know. So yeah.
Well, I'm glad. That's a great attitude to have, right? Especially in the middle of the week. So, you know, your name kept popping up, I believe, on LinkedIn, which is always a great way to kind of scan and find out who's talking and writing about introverts. And you were writing some very interesting pieces on that. And I wanted to ask you, just to start out with, how you got into this topic, because I know you work in a regular full-time job at Elsevier, but which, by the way, I don't know if you, I'm going to go segue here on my introvert style, but just a little bit offshoot here. The first book I wrote with Bill, the introverted husband of mine, we collaborated. It was our first and last project together, writing a book, but Elsevier was the publisher. So I had and we actually went to England. It was that division then, and I think they've morphed since then. So I immediately was connecting with you on that level. But tell me how you connected with introversion. And first of all, are you one?
Great question to open up with. So yes, I am an introvert. I have introvert preferred tendencies. And I knew this only late in my life. Early in my life, I knew there was something different about me. So, you know, being in school and the one who enjoyed solitary play rather than, you know, being in the groups or at parents' evening when, you know, that scene where all the different tables are in the gym and all the teachers are talking to the parents and, you know, they put my predicted grades in front of my father and he can be very proud because they were pretty good grades. And then the teacher would talk about, yeah, which is good, good, good. But, you know, that pejorative.
Yeah,
he's, you know, he's a bit quiet in class, doesn't really put his hand up and, you know, doesn't want to give talks in front of the class, et cetera, et cetera. And my father was, you know, really defensive and rightly so, because he was like, well, look, his grades are doing well. So clearly there's something around the teaching style that needs to change to make sure it's more inclusive. And it was way before people were talking, you know, about personality diversity as we kind of do now. So, you know, but fast forward to that book from Susan Cain, Quiet. And after reading that, I was like, oh, okay. So I'm part of this club who are, well, now, according to Myers-Briggs, what, 50-something percent of the world. So, you know, called introverts. And I thought to myself, if I'm going through similar kind of pushback or struggles in terms of getting one's voice heard in the workplace and being left behind because we're not doing the Friday night socials in the bars and pubs and whatever, in the pubs in the UK for sure. You know, what are some of the tactics and tools that we can adopt to keep pace and, you know, when possible, you know, get ahead? So that's when I decided to do some research and reading into that. And I now run a series of masterclasses for the Guardian newspaper on how to be heard as an introvert professional.
Right. I want to get to those in just a moment. Going back to your dad's, the experience you heard that your dad reported back to you, did anything change after that in school in terms of, certainly you felt accepted by your dad, which is very important for kids, right? To know that there's nothing wrong with them because they are quiet. What was school like for you as a more introverted kid who, as you say, played alone and kind of did their work alone, which now we know is very important in terms of productivity. But what was your experience like?
So I loved school in terms of its setup. You know, you spend a certain amount of hours with people similar age to you, and you are continually learning. Like every night I went to bed, I knew something that I didn't know the morning I woke up. And that fueled me. I loved that. Mm-hmm. And in terms of classroom setup, however, despite my father's many attempts to encourage teachers to approach the teaching style differently, so, you know, he wasn't criticizing them as teachers, it didn't change. And I empathize with those teachers because they didn't receive any training from the, you know, the educational departments and so forth. And or maybe they didn't know they needed training, right? It's not something that wasn't front of mind. They knew they had a curriculum that they had to teach, and they did it the best way they could. And, you know, I didn't go to a fee-paying school, so, you know, they only had finite resources. And, they did the best they could. So I did what I could in the environment to get ahead. And, you know, this is why I'm really pleased to be on this podcast, because I did have allies, you know, throughout my time in school, primarily senior teachers who were probably also introverts, actually.
Yeah, I was going to ask you, do you remember any of them who particularly supported you and advocated for you?
Yeah, I mean, I remember names like Miss Peacock when I was in primary school. I remember Mr. Hurley, who was my...
You sure she wasn't from the Clue game, Mrs. Peacock in the library? I couldn't resist.
Who knows? Who knows? Isn't it wonderful that you can always remember your favorite teachers, no matter how you become? It was wonderful.
They made teachers make an incredible difference. So you figured out a way to kind of get through school, succeed.
I was self-employed. I set up a video production company. This is before YouTube was around, and I created promotional videos for local businesses who needed videos for their websites. And that's how I, you know, after doing a few evening courses in a few colleges, got into communication and marketing. And I've been in that industry ever since.
Did you make videos as a child or as a young person? Were you interested in film and back then?
Definitely interested in film back then. My parents didn't own a video camera when I was younger. However, I did draw a lot of storyboards. I didn't know they were called storyboards back then, but you know, that's what I drew. And I thought I was doing comic strips. And so when I was younger, I actually wrote and drew what were now essentially storyboards. I just didn't know they were storyboards at the time. I thought I was drawing a comic strip. And it's primarily storytelling. And this is something that I love doing even now. And whether it's through film or through the internal communications that I do at Elsevier, where I work, it's just my life. I love it. I really do love telling other people's stories. And I did tell my own story once in a documentary.
Yes. Tell us about that, if you could. What was that was about Dominica, about your roots from there, right? And that was at some point you felt you wanted to share that story.
Indeed. No, you got me, Jennifer. All right. I did a little bit
of research. That's what I've learned from all the introverts. You got to do some research.
Oh, yeah, because we're right? We dream about to do it. Yeah.
I know.
Both my parents were born in the small but beautiful Caribbean island of Dominica, which is situated in between Guadeloupe and Martinique in the lesser interlies of the Caribbean. And both my parents came to the UK very young. My father was 8, my mom was 11, and they never returned. And my father actually passed away before ever going back. And so we didn't go back as kids. I didn't really have an affinity or connection to Dominica. Everything I knew about it was, you know, second, third-hand stories. And so when the 10th anniversary of my father's passing was approaching, there's a documentary here in the UK and the BBC called Who Do You Think You Are? And what it does, it's a genealogy documentary, essentially. And it follows the lineage of a particular individual back to as far as it goes. And they travel to the said, you know, countries. And I thought, do you know what? I'm going to do that for me and my father. So, yeah, picked up my camera. I did a bit of fundraising locally with local businesses before heading over. In fact, some of those businesses I actually created videos for. So, it all comes around full circle.
Yes, of course.
And, headed over and created a documentary which has since won a couple of awards and featured in many international film festivals. It's called The ID Project, My Dominica Story. I've put it on YouTube for free. There's a fundraising button to raise funds for sarcoidosis UK because there still isn't a cure for the rare autoimmune disease that my father passed away from. So, yeah. It's out there. It's in fact, just last month, it was in the Windrush Caribbean Film Festival because the Windrush generation celebrated 75 years in the UK last
month. Well, I'm sure your dad and certainly your whole family is proud, very proud of your doing this. Let me ask you what's it like being an introvert or self-proclaimed introvert and also directing a film? Are there any challenges because you're managing so many moving parts, you're not just behind the camera. Did you find anything stressful and how have you managed to handle that?
Stressful, yes. So patience, I think I'm a little bit of a perfectionist and a control freak. And so having patience was important because I had to remember other people, certain people will not keep pace. And so, you know, giving feedback, that's something that needs a lot of patience as well, because some individuals won't pick things up as quickly as one does, as I would do. And I have to, I had to remember constantly, you know, this is in my head, people can't read my mind. As an introvert, being super considered and you know, introspective, that was definitely a challenge. However, you know, I have had and have mentors that I would speak with and they would give me some feedback. And the great thing about mentors, and this is a tip as well for everyone,
yes, please.
Try to find mentors who, yes, are like you, but also the opposite of you. So I have extroverted mentors who are like a brand new mirror to me. They help me to see myself in a way that I don't. And they also help to open doors that I probably wouldn't have gone to because, you know, I'm not as social and there's a lot of networking that needs to happen to unlock certain.
But you have to pull on those strengths, right? Because they're all within you. So those mentors help you with that is what I'm hearing.
Yes, exactly that.
Great. And so the results speak for themselves. I'm sure there were a lot of strengths too as an introvert that you bring to the filmmaking role. Can you think of any that pop up that, you know, you as an introvert, you said you're very considered, you have your vision.
Yes.
Right? You want the film to be.
In fact, the biggest thing actually that comes to mind is the connection. You know, introverts are really good at that one-to-one connection. So when it came to interviewing or speaking with the interview subjects, those individuals that I would like to partake in the film, just like yourself, Jennifer, you know, I did my research. You know, I approached them in a way that I'm pretty sure many others wouldn't have. And that is what encouraged them to say yes. And that's why I was able to get in the film, not just, you know, for Miss World Dominica at the time. I was able to get the president, the prime minister, the man who invented the flag when we gained independence in the 70s. The, you know, cultural ministers, the historians. There were so many people that said yes to this film, and I was so humbled by that. So yeah, definitely that connection is the biggest thing.
Connection. And you build trust among people. And we make sure that we put this in the show notes. I do have a question for you regarding something that you said, and you may not remember this, or maybe you do, on one of your interviews. You talked about how you're not so much, and this is very common with introverts I've interviewed, that you don't like to share a lot of private details about yourself. Maybe in the beginning, maybe never with people. And I'm just curious, what's your stance on that? That we do find that create some friction between introverts and extroverts, because that's how extroverts oftentimes relate, right? They share, they tell you almost TMI sometimes, right? And introverts tend to be the opposite. And so if they're trying to build trust with each other, there can be a disconnect. I wonder what's your thoughts on that, and what would you share with those of us who are trying to support introverts regarding sharing private information, you know, like the details of your life?
So I totally understand the journey that groups would need to go through to, you know, connect to that kind of forming, norming, storming, etc. kind of cycle. However, my thoughts on not sharing too early is about trust. And because I go deep quickly, I have to trust the person I'm speaking to. You know, I'm not very good, that's not true. I'm getting better at small talk and surface discussions, and whereas my desire is to really get to know that individual, and I know that to get to know someone very well, I need to also give a bit of me as in kind. So my view is, personally, I don't share my innermost details or private information until I've built that trust. And I know on social media, it's a faceless crowd. So there's an element of that as well, which kind of adds extra restraint to show more. However, I'm learning through my son. He's 13. And, you know, even when he was a toddler, he would hug everyone. You know, anyone on the street, he just want to hug them. And, you know, you give your children, don't just go and disturb strangers type talk. But, you know, he's always been very open and wears his heart on his sleeve. And actually, he's an inspiration to me. So I'm finding myself, and also through therapy as well, like, I have tactics now, or like ways of being a bit more goofy, a bit more open. Like, I have a childish streak, and I would love to just be me in front of more people, because otherwise we find ourselves wearing many masks. And
that's a good way to put it.
Yeah, not to get too deep and say we may lose who we really are. However, there is a danger that we keep the masks on longer than we have them off. So I really am trying my best to find balance at the moment. And I guess I'll need to get feedback from wonderful individuals like you.
Mm-hmm. Well, people can't see, but you're doing a lot of smiling. So that's, I think that's probably natural. And there's nothing like kids to help loosen us up, right?
Right, exactly.
So that's really interesting. There is one thing I want to ask you about in your bio that was, you know, I'm sure other people want to know too. And that's you were supporting or working with Theresa May, the former prime minister. And just let's talk a little bit about what, you know, how you came into that role and what it is that you did with her. What'd you learn from that experience? Those are a couple of questions I threw in there, but
that's fine. I'll just pick them up randomly. So
there you go. You're acting extroverted, Richard. Randomly, I love it. We've rubbed off on you, haven't we?
So the way I got into that role, so I, as I said earlier, I did a lot of video production and promotion for various companies. And then I entered the civil service over in the UK. And I joined the Cabinet Office and led the content production for what was then the Commonwealth Heads of Government meeting, or CHOGM as it's known, because London was the host in 2018. And what having that role did was give me exposure to all the Commonwealth Heads of State. So I'm rubbing shoulders, you know, with Trudeau and Ramaphosa and, you know, all of the Commonwealth, you know, heads of, plus the royal family. And when that was all over, my manager at the time got the call from Downing Street saying that the videographer they had of 10 years was leaving and they needed someone pretty pronto. And I think the question was, do you know anyone that's qualified? And he was like, I think I may know a guy.
I know a guy.
Yeah, right. And I was about to head off to the Home Office, actually. I just got a role and I was about to head there. And he's like, actually, you may want to have a talk with this other employer that I've got lined up. I was like, oh, who is this? And it was Downing Street. So I went around, I went to the house. A couple of people, you know, greeted me, gave me the tour. Listen, when I say they courted me, they took me to all of the trinkets, they showed me a piece of moon rock that was gifted. They showed me, the Chilean miners. Remember the Chilean miners that were rescued? There was a note from them and a piece from the miners, like, oh, yeah, you know, there was a artwork installation from Tracy Emin.
Like the British Museum, huh?
Right. And they took me to the Rose Garden and sat me down. Would you like some tea? I was like, okay, what's going on here then? And and then I received a brief from the then director of communications, who basically said, could you make Theresa May, you know, more personable online?
Oh boy.
Yeah. And I was like, okay, I think I could do that, because at the time, she had, unfortunately, picked up a nickname called Maybot or something like that, which was, I was basically alluding to her being a bit stiff on camera. And so, yeah, I was given the task of, the opportunity, I wouldn't even call it a task, of just getting her to, appeal to more of our electorate online. And it was wonderful being with her. You know, she got I called her one take May. She would come into the room, she would record her messages or whatever, and done. No mistakes. None. Zero. And she was always polite. She'd always have a little joke. And she'd go about her business. And it's just unfortunate that at the time, you know, we had the Brexit negotiations happening. And so the news was constantly Brexit, Brexit with Theresa May. So what I did, I took it upon myself to ensure that the videos that I put out showed the many, like the multifaceted role that she had. You know, she worked in armed forces. She was, you know, she hosted receptions for every single religious denomination you could think of, you know, when they had their special event for the year. She was very close with the community, underrepresented groups, you know, school, education, housing. Education for girls was big for Mrs. May. And one of the cutest things I will share is that her and her husband had a bond like I've not seen probably since my own parents. So, you know, she had a rule where no matter where we went, we couldn't be away for longer than 3 nights. She liked to be with her husband. And so I remember we went to Buenos Aires. We were like 30 hours combined there and back in the air. But probably only spent a day there because we had to get back. And, you know, I would always be the last person to leave after all the cars have gone home because I have to drop my equipment into the house. And I looked at the door with her, and who would be standing at the foot of the stairs but her husband? And it's, yeah, it was just always, it was a wonderful.
Could you just share before we move on, what was it? Do you remember anything that you suggested to her to make her less stiff and what, you know, how she kind of warmed up on camera? You said you helped her do that, kind of like just become more personable. I think that's a lesson all of us could take.
Yeah, it's. I think location, location, location. There's a TV show with the same name over here. And it's, you know, before a lot of her address, state addresses were in the stateroom with, you know, ornate, you know, kind of chandelier, clocks and whatever in the background. But actually, no, it was, you know, getting her out to, on the road, you know. So, you know, every single morning before we went on a trip, if we were on a plane, on a train, wherever, I'd get her to do a quick click to camera saying, you know, this, we're off to X location to do this wonderful thing, which will help X, Y, and Z people. And then I'd have a nice little kind of highlights reel and kind of wrap that up. So
that's helpful.
It is really helpful. Nice little day diary for people to see how the woman in the toughest job in the country is working her socks off for us.
It makes me think of the other former prime minister, and you'll remember Thatcher, whose voice was a turnoff to people. Remember, they worked with her on that for to connect more with the people. So love that story, and I'm sure you share with it. One other thing I wanted to ask you about, you talk in your classes, and maybe now's a good time to you just give us a quick overview of what you teach with the Guardian. You teach master classes. You help people, particularly introverts, do self-promotion, which you say is really more in the domain of extroverts, is kind of more natural to us, which I would agree with. But it can create a challenge, right? When you're in anything that you're doing, not to be able to talk about your work, not in a bragging way, but just to share with people what you're up to. And so I wonder, you know, tell me a little bit about how you address that in your classes.
Yes. So I think the line I use a lot is, you know, how to make your voice heard right at the back of the room if you're not, you know, usually the loudest. And I do it in three ways. I the first one is to talk about how to strengthen and define one's personal brand. Because once you know what your value is and what you represent, you're then able to promote said brand in a genuine and authentic way. So that's the first thing. The second thing is how to network with confidence. And, you know, networking, I say, is merely a conversation. It's just about reframing it. Because some people hear the word networking and it literally frees up. But when I say, you know, you network all of the time, you know, if you go into the office and you go to someone in accounts to ask them for something, you're networking. That is a conversation. You are speaking with someone new to get something, a mutually beneficial gain. And so I talk about offline networking as well as online, such as LinkedIn, hence how, you know, how we met, right?
Mm-hmm, right.
Yeah. And then the final part is around how to overcome self-sabotage barriers. I don't like to use the term imposter syndrome. You know, I'm not a fan of that. I think those words just don't resonate with me, and I don't want people to kind of think that is them, right? So, you know, how to overcome these barriers that we impose on oneself, and then using those to develop successful, say, interview techniques, presentation skills like public speaking, whether again offline or online, because there are different techniques and approaches that need to be made with those two different mediums. So, yeah, those are the three kind of.
You're the man. You're the man to teach this. I love it. And tell, what kind of results are you having or feedback are you getting from these classes you're teaching?
I mean, it's overwhelmingly positive. I mean, I've been doing this for 6 years and sell out pretty much as soon as they go live. I used to do them obviously before, not obviously, but before the pandemic, it was in person, but now it's online. And now I have, you know, businesses reaching out to me and asking if I can do like lunch and learn sessions, or, you know, even speaking to their, was it EDI, equity?
Oh, employee resource groups.
Exactly. About personality diversity in the workplace, you know, how to actually empower both introverts and extroverts. It's not an us versus them conversation. It's a parity of voice and allyship, active allyship conversation. So I'm really enjoying having these classes, master classes with these such individuals, because it was a conversation that was so front of mind during lockdown, probably season one and two, when it was getting a bit much for everyone for different reasons. And it was like, okay, but now I know what my personality needs in order to feel fulfilled and to thrive. How can we bring this into the workplace culture so that everyone can be the best version of themselves?
Yes. And I think organizations are more open now to having these discussions than they ever were right before. So no, very good. So you'll let us know. I know that you also have free downloads on your website.
Indeed, yes. I have two ebooks, very short ebooks. One is the Introvert Survival Guide, and the next one is Self-Promotion for Introverts.
You're an ally, you're an advocate for sure. So another question that just before we wind down things, you know, people talk about the intersectionality. I've done some work on men and introverts with a colleague of mine. You were on a podcast with Hush Loudly, I believe it's called, on the intersection of Black professionals who are introverts. You know, I know that's kind of like a, it probably could be a long answer to it, but anything that we should think about when we're dealing with, when we're working with our Black clients, our colleagues, our leaders who are introverted, you know, anything you would just throw out as some suggested thoughts on that?
I would definitely say to be mindful of misconceptions or preconceived kind of stereotypes of what the Black individual's behavior should be like. You know, not all Black men are, you know, loud, talkative, you know, I don't know what the word is, but like, you know, eccentric, you know, and also the same with Black women. We see roles in films and TVs where they are the ones that do the jokes and they're the loud ones, and that's not every single Black individual. So, you know, when there is a quieter Black individual in your team, to then ask, are you okay? Is everything, you know, everything all right? Doesn't really sit well usually with said individual, because that's not everyone. We're not all the same. And then there's, unfortunately, because of, again, you know, racism or stereotypes or, you know, discrimination, the data is there to show that, you know, Black people do sit behind in the pay gap, you know, the ethnicity pay gap, also the gender pay gap. They're all but absent at the very top, you know, kind of C-suite levels of business. So imagine on top of being Black, you are also introverted. So not one whose natural mode is to speak up in meetings or to network or to go out and socialize in a way that is perceived the norm elsewhere. You know, there's a lot of cultural significance in the way that we behave. You know, as a Caribbean descendant, you know, child of Caribbean parents, I was told to be seen and not heard. I was told to not, you know, kind of speak up.
Express yourself. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, don't talk back to authority. Don't try and change things. And because of that, yeah, maybe that could have made me even quieter than had, you know, I had a different type of upbringing. And so it's just to raise awareness.
Be aware, right? Be aware. Don't make assumptions.
What I don't want, though, is to create another box.
No. But I think that it's also, we're talking about there are so few in organizations. Like, you know, you're sitting in meetings and you're the only Black person and then you're quiet. You got, right? So it's just, again, to be aware and to change our practices so that we don't do things the same way all the time. Like we say, you know, break up people into one-on-ones or get to know them. So, and when you, once you're aware, I think that's what we're trying to do with this podcast is show all the various nuances of what introversion can look like and in your organization, how it can take on different form, how you, if you have that lens, how then you can change practices, right? To not just do it the same old way.
Indeed. Because there's a, so on my, there's a website, blackintrovertweek.uk. And
is that you too?
That's me. That is me.
You're so humble. You didn't even mention that one.
It is to raise awareness. It is to educate and also to create more allies and also to give voice, added voice to Black introverts. It's important that they are able to tell their story, but also meet other Black introverts so they don't feel so alone. How can we just make this world just a more equitable place where people don't feel like they have to, as I said, I alluded to earlier, don so many masks? You know, I want, you know, you hear companies say, I want you to bring your whole self to work.
Yeah.
I mean, that's not really going to happen, right? Like, it's not. But let's encourage people to bring as much of the person that they want to be, you know, to work.
Now that's a quotable quote. A lot of quotable quotes, but I'm going to, I love pulling that one out. All right. Well, I want to be respectful of your time. Is there anything we haven't covered that you'd like to make sure that you let folks know about, Richard?
Yeah, thank you. I can give you all of the links to things if that helps.
Please do. Richard, you've shared so much gold with us today about the life of an introvert who really focuses on communication as his ace in the hole, but does it in a way that really pulls in his qualities and strengths as an introvert. So I know that's going to be a huge plus for everybody listening. And I've learned so much from you today. So I just want to thank you for spending the time with us on the Introvert Ally podcast. And I look forward to having you come and share as your wonderful journey continues.
Thank you, Jennifer. And thank you, everyone, for listening as well. I really appreciate it.
That wraps up another episode of the Introvert Ally podcast. Thanks so much for listening. If you found value from our podcast, we'd love you to subscribe, rate, and review us on your favorite platform. Also, please do share it with others. Thanks, and I'll see you next time.